All right, everyone. So for day three of our lecture, what we're going to do is we have a video that we created together. If you've still got a copy of it from previous days, we will use it. If you don't have it from the previous day, we can use mine. You can get a copy of my video. Your computer should be on either Windows or Mac. You should see a web design folder on the desktop. Double-click web design. And then you should see a folder that says CIS255 at the top there. So if you open CIS255, I've got the starting point. If you still want a copy of that, that's got the video clip and the sound. And then I've got the number two here. It's the end result. So that's the one with the Movie Maker project file and the finished video. So if you'd like to use a copy of my video for what we're about to do, you can just go to that folder, into folder number two, and just drag a copy of the video called Tech Review Tuesday, episode 4, Motorola Moto E. Just drag that to your desktop, just so you have something to upload to YouTube. And we'll use it in just a moment. This one ended up in total 1 minute, 22 seconds, in my case, 19 megabytes. But depending on the kind of video you record, is it HD quality? Does it have a lot of graphics? Is it complex? What's the length of it? It could easily get into dozens or hundreds of megabytes to upload. So that's always a consideration about, for example, here on campus, we have really good internet connections. We should be able to upload our videos really quickly. But at home, usually even with the higher end video, the higher end internet providers, their upload speeds are usually pretty bad. All of these companies like AT&T and Cox and Time Warner, they're always going to be telling you about how great the speeds are, how great the download speeds are. You may get a 50 megabit download speed, but they don't tell you, and you're going to get maybe 5 megabits upload speed. So whenever you create these videos and then it's time to upload them, it's usually then going to take a while because upload speeds are always a problem. So what I will do now that I've got a video to upload, I will open the web browser and let's go back to youtube.com and we will log into the account that we started to use last time. So use your login information from last time to log into YouTube. Hello. So we're going to log back into YouTube and we can use a copy of the video that I provided you if you'd like.
So if I invited someone to, I don't know, collaborate or contribute to my YouTube channel, would their login experience be like yours right now, where you logged in and all kinds of options popped up?
Yeah, when you add more accounts, you then have to decide which of your YouTube accounts to work with. So that's what I'm trying to remember, which one did I create? And I found it here now. So, yeah, as you add more collaborators, if you add, as you add more people, give more people access to the account. You will have, as we saw in the top right corner, a place to click to switch between accounts. When I first logged in, it's asking me which account to use, and then I jump to different accounts. But here, if you've got only one, it'll take you to it directly. Okay, so we spent some time previously looking at our settings and such. Remember that we have the consumer version of YouTube and the creator version of YouTube. As soon as I signed in here, I'm back to the consumer version about watch this video or subscribe to this channel or whatever. I want to switch over to the creator view of YouTube. Anyone remember how to do that?
How do you do one of them?
Switch back to the creator view. You click on your icon on the top right, and there it is, Creator Studio. So let's switch to Creator Studio. And this shows us our Creator Studio. This shows us where we would have our list of our videos. We might get tips. Then we have this analytics screen here. This will show you your hits, your views, your watch time, all of that, subscribers. So I just created this channel. I don't have anything to show for it, but I can compare that with some other accounts that I have just to see what that looks like. And then this will be all of your data. So we spent some time, remember, if you click on channel on the left side, on channel we had all of these different settings that we went through overall. And you wanted to go through them, set up some things like verify the account and all of that to get the full access. So here's various settings right here of this channel. These other buttons here on the side. Once we upload videos, we'll be able to check the analytics. So nothing is very impressive here at the moment. If you click on analytics though, this is the screen that it'll tell you so much great detail. It'll give you, in general, your stats, but then it'll tell you, okay, take me to real time. So you'll see at the moment who's watching your videos, which video, and all of that. Reports on the time, watch, and audience retention. This will tell you minute by minute, second by second, when your video is playing, people were really engaged and paying attention for the first 30 seconds, and then it starts to go down, and then people stop caring 1 minute in. But your video is 5 minutes long. So that's a way for you to tell, am my videos too long? Are they too short? It's the audience retention. Again, with a new account like this, there's not much to see. But it'll tell you demographics and your traffic sources. Where are people coming from to watch my videos? What are the devices they're using? All of this information is very valuable for us as SEO people, because we need to know who is watching, what are they watching, what do they care, where are they coming from, because then you can decide to make content that really targets that audience. So we'll look at analytics later, perhaps after we get some data and we upload something. If we look at Creator, under this panel here, this is the audio library that I was saying about all of this music that we can use for our projects. Let's take a look at this, because this is very valuable, but it has some nuances. Go to audio library, you'll see all of these sounds, which you can organize by genre, mood, etc. Let's see, genre, I want to go with something jazz and blues, so it whittles it down. Maybe a mood of dramatic, gives me some other results. And then maybe duration, I want just a quick 1 minute song. In this case, I don't have any of that, because I don't think a short jazz song exists. But here, then I'm putting it at three minutes. Okay, now I'm getting some results. Yes.
Yeah, like let's say there's like a free song on the internet that person randomly made, but it was very popular, and you're able to use it on your channel, no problem. Mm-hmm. And you put the description to give some credit for the artist in your description of the video. Would that boost your SEO or your search overall, or will that kind of put you in the wrong category that you don't want to be at?
I don't think the sound of a video can really affect the SEO or your findability and such.
No, I'm talking about like giving credit to the artist on your description page part.
Well, you'll sort of be helping the artist more than yourself because you are linking to them and therefore possibly driving traffic to them. If the opposite were true, that on their site as the artist, they have a link back to your YouTube or your website, that'll definitely help you. But I don't believe there's much of a value, no negative value or positive value for you to link over to them SEO-wise. The one positivity I would see about that is that it helps with your copyright issues. But I don't think there's much about that regarding SEO positivity for you.
The only way is if someone searching for that artist is somehow still a qualified viewer. Because then by searching that artist's name, right, they may stumble across it. But it's not likely though, huh? It's just a small part. If the rest of the content on there isn't really about that.
Because you've got the title of your video that is most likely not going to mention that song or that artist. You've got a description that we're going to write that most likely isn't going to mention too much about it except a quick shout out. You've got tags that we'll talk about too that also really don't mention that particular artist or song, so there's not much that will be found.
Google will try to serve up the relevant. The more relevant content for the query.
Yeah, so if your particular entry doesn't have too much of relevancy, it might not appear. So here I'm kind of browsing around, so I have Beer Belly Blues and Minor Mush. You can click there to play it. All right, so different songs. What you get when you look at all of these is these various columns. I'm going to reset it back to defaults. You get a length of the song, the artist, style, and such. Then you get this little meter of popularity. So this is showing you at a glance what other people are also using that song. There's no numbers that say 10,000 other people use that song or 7 other people use it. It's just this is popular, quote unquote. You may or may not care about this because if I found Big Mojo Vadorada and other people did too, everyone's going to sound like this song. Or Bird in the Hand. So what I'm getting at is that if you like a song and the popularity is high, that meant a lot of other people like the song. And therefore, if you care, your video will sound like someone else's. You may or may not care about that.
Do I have to give attribution to the link of the artist?
Yeah, that's what I'm about to get to. So then we've got the download button. So if you do end up liking a particular song, you can easily download it. It gives it to you in MP3 format, and then we can open it in Movie Maker. Now, one particular icon that is right here that some have and some don't, this little person, which to me looks like the men's room logo, but this is the attribution logo. Some songs, all of the songs here are okay for you to use on your projects, but the ones that are marked here, you need to give credit somehow in your work to the original artist. And they will tell you usually, here, you're free to use this song in any of your videos, but you must include the following in your video description. So you better copy and paste that into your video to be able to use this song. I never remember about that, so what I do is, under the search here, go to attribution, not required. And it won't even bother to show you any of those that you have to then deal with. Now that might not be any problem at all to give that attribution. But I personally don't deal with that because I've got better things to do. So I have it set up here on the attribution not required, download the song, get to work, and all of that. I don't have to give any credit. YouTube has said use this song however you want, and I do. So that's all personal for you to do or not, but if you set it here, just download the song and use it. And this is hundreds of songs, and they add some all the time.
I have a question. With such a crazy, honestly, I've looked through it recently. And it's got really good stuff on it. Is there still any additional benefit to go to these other places that will sell you a song for like $20 or something? Or is the only benefit that, oh, you sound cooler because less people, because it's not even like you're the only one, less people have it. You know what I mean?
That's the thing. You pay for uniqueness or exclusivity, and depending how much you would care about that, that would be a big thing. So yeah, if you paid 20, so did 100 other people instead of 10,000 other people getting that song. So if that matters, it matters. Like
just
in
background
in,
music, huh?
Well, it could, again, depending on the person. There's one particular video that I have up here that, you know, in all of these years, honestly, I think maybe once off the top of my head, I can think about someone else's video that also has the same song that I've used. And I heard it, and I'm like, oh, that's my song. Not really, because everyone else is using it too. But it's been rare for me to run into that. So this isn't the only place, of course, but as you scroll down, there's lots of songs here. So here's the place. This is the song that I gave you 2 weeks ago to work on the project. I got it from in here. I forgot what I searched for, but I searched around. I found some song, and we put it in our project. That's what I recommend for you to do if you're going to use any sound in your projects. Don't get that sound out of your iTunes. Don't get it off of your phone. Don't get it off of that CD. Don't search on Google or Bing. Just go to these places that give you these songs where you're the most safe. This is not the only place. There's also the Free Music Archive. You can go look at this one on your own, freemusicarchive.org. It's built into Movie Maker. Remember, there was Add Sound, and then it said Free Music Archive. There's another place to go to find free music. You can go look at that on your own. And so here on YouTube, we have the free music. We also have sound effects. So what if I need some sound effects? Categories horror. For example, what if you're making a video about the apocalypse? Here's aggressive zombie snarls. There you go, free for you to download. Dissecting a body, dropping meat, female aggressive zombie, female monster attacking. So anyway, YouTube gives you music and sound effects. That's under the Create window here. Music policies. This directory lists songs and their current policies. Okay. So you actually can, to some degree, use the music of real artists and such. For example, here's Rihanna. But you have to read here how you can and cannot see it. If you use this song, it's viewable everywhere except Germany. So if you use this song in your video, people all over the world, except for Germany, will be able to see your video. And ads can appear on your video if you have chosen to use that, because she needs to get paid. If you perform a cover, it's viewable worldwide. So if you perform that song yourself, if you cover it somehow, it'll appear worldwide, and there'll be an ad. For these, I don't believe you can monetize these. I'd have to double check, but again, I never bother with these, because there's these hoops. I don't want to jump through these hoops. I just want to be creative and do something, so I'm not going to even bother with these. But if you really need to use a particular song from a real artist, there's Drake. You can use track 20 from Drake. This track is not available for it to use in YouTube. If you use this song, your video may be blocked or muted. So there's all of this. Prince, there's When Doves Cry. This song is not available for you to use on YouTube.
So even stuff that you shouldn't be using is there, it's more of a reference tool, right?
It's more of a reference, exactly.
Wow. And they don't have any quick filter way to, you know how like the little guy, quick way to find out, well, which one can I use?
You mean yourself to search?
No, you know how right on the previous one.
Oh yes, the little attribution thing.
Little men's bathroom guy, you know?
No, they're not making it that easy here. You do have to check here. Can I use Lucas Graham's 7 years? You have to click to see, yes, you can use it, except in two countries in the world. So nope, there's no quick way to show that for you. You have to search it. You have to then.
Kind of with the cover.
It'll be a cover. The last thing that we've got here is then the video editor. Now, we don't have anything to do with it here, but here's some very basic video editor built into YouTube. I believe you need Google Chrome for this to work, or Safari. So this works by you, one of your videos, you can use it. Create video, your project was to include at least one video. So you have to have a video uploaded, and then you're going to have some basic things such as drag clips together, audio sounds, crop a few things about it, add some, oh, here we go, you can take these, this stock image, and you can put together a stock video, you know, a video out of stock imagery, if you wanted. So that basic editor there, I hardly use it because I think the Movie Maker or iMovie is much better. Here it relies on an existing video that you've uploaded to YouTube before you can use it. So then that would be pretty cumbersome, I think, to upload all your clips that you uploaded to YouTube, wait for all of that upload time, and then get to this editor. Whereas on your own computer, you've got your clips, you can use the video editor then right away. Let's look at community. Here is where you would see the comments that people are adding to your posts. And if you activated the feature over here under channel of upload defaults, if you activated allow comments that are approved, remember this is not on by default, it says any crazy comment can come onto my video, and I recommend put it on approved. If you set that up, no comments will show up on your videos until you approve, the good ones or the bad ones. And to approve them, they're over here under community. Comments, they'll be listed here, you can read them, you can approve them, you can trash them. You can have control over your message on YouTube. You can do messaging between accounts. A list of all your subscribers will be there. If people have contributed to help you with your captions, this was something you might have activated in the settings. Nowadays, people can help write the captions for your videos. They will be listed here, so you can approve them or not. Your subtitles, other community settings. Here's where you would go. Okay, this might be a quick useful thing to look at under community settings. Approved users, hidden users, blacklist. So ways for you to control who can use your page. Show popular comments. But what I'm getting at is what you could do is notice the default here, comments on your channel. That one's kind of hidden in there. People could have the ability to comment on your channel itself, not just your videos. And the default is, let any crazy person write any crazy thing on my channel. Well, it might be a good idea to change to hold all comments for review. And then once you read them and you see all the good ones, let those in.
Do spammer kind of community people go in and comment, like, oh, cool video, but check out mine, mine's better, boom, and put a link or no?
Yeah.
Or do they make links active?
YouTube makes links active.
Wow.
So we can have that happen, that people can comment, but they're just putting in a stealth link to get traffic to themselves.
Is there any way to prevent that?
The link?
Yeah.
No, if someone is going to comment and you have this approval, at least you can stop them, but if they put in links that you don't want on their comment, you can't do anything about it except delete the comment. You can't take away the link.
Is there any good, you know how with the Google Plus, they kind of give a quick walkthrough of like, hey, this is the community, these are some good practices, or whatever. Is there any part you as a part of this YouTube community that you should do? You know what I mean?
Back on the dashboard, as you use it, you'll start to see these tips here. So you'll see get local updates, let's see, view all. Only one is popping up at the moment, but as you use it more, as you actually upload videos, it's going to start to tell you, remember to do this on your videos, or try this, or best practices. So those tips will help you there. But they've also got their whole help section. What's new? There's help somewhere. Right there, help. If you go into YouTube help, there's a bunch of advice and help and all of that on all of that stuff too. Let's see, credits.
Can we choose our own custom URL now?
I don't believe so yet. They changed the rules so that now you need to have at least 100. You can do yours.
Yeah.
What screen are you looking at? Just so that if I see mine.
On the tips, it says your channel is eligible for a new custom URL.
Oh, that's cool. I don't know, for various factors, you might have that ability to. So you're saying you're just seeing it here on the tips?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. If you see it, get that name so that you get a nice short name. I think it depends on various things, and I'm seeing that it seems that 100, it needs 100 subscribers for many people. If you get lucky with that, then go ahead and get it. We've got the live streaming feature. It says stream now, beta. When is something not beta in Google? So here we are able to, if we wanted to set this up, to plug in a web camera and use some software and such. And it says you need to verify your account and all of that, and then you'll have an ability to do live videos. So that might be useful because that's different, that's interesting. We're getting into YouTube, but YouTube's been around a decade. Live video is the newer thing that's starting to pick up steam in the last few years. There's Periscope and Meerkat and Twitch TV and Justin TV and all of that, Ustream. All of these networks that are about sharing something live, because maybe this polished sort of edited videos don't reach the particular audience that you're looking for. But that's a different kettle of fish we won't really have a time to do. And you can set up events so that you can set up, on this day and time, we will have this broadcast. And then Video Manager. I don't have any videos yet. We'll add one in just a moment. We've got videos and we've got playlists. Playlists are ways to group together videos. So if you do group together videos into a playlist, the advantage of that is that when someone starts to watch one of your videos, you can guide them to another one of your videos a lot easier. Because when they're in a playlist, you're going to play this one, then this one, then this one, then this one. So we need videos first before adding them to playlists, although I think we can create a playlist without any video. We'll do that later. Let's talk then about uploading a video and all the things we need to do to optimize. Any questions so far?
I have one, but I don't know if it's quite great. The YouTube Red,
mm-hmm.
as a creator or whatever, do they limit to only like premium content that they're, you know what I mean, the $9.99 a month for?
Honestly, that's one of my to-do lists to figure it out. I don't know too much about it. Although I see in my analytics I didn't do anything special on my accounts, and on my analytics I'm seeing data that says, you know, data from a regular user and data from a Red user. So I don't know if we get that as creators eat for free or what advantage there is.
So that'd be cool if people, that's kind of where you're providing your content, and then I wonder if they share the revenue of the $9.99 with you since your content.
I'm pretty sure because
no longer it's going to be generating ad revenue.
I don't know how they're going to do it because I did see in my dashboard for one of these accounts it did say, you know, 2 cents off of a video.
Supposedly, from what I heard, YouTube Red, how it monetizes for creators is whatever amount of time your users, your YouTube Red users spend watching your videos, you earn that. That much of their $9.99 per month.
Oh.
So that's why you want to encourage them to be like a frequent viewer so that you earn more of that chunk of their subscription fee.
That sounds good, because the other way is like if someone clicks an ad, I might earn off of that, and it looks like with Red, well, it's more about actually paying attention to the video. Yeah, well, that's good to know. Thank you for that. So we need to create cool videos to keep people coming back for more.
Do you guys know of anything about like, all right, I made this content, it's cool, I spent a lot of time, but I only want it for Red subscribers.
Again, to me, I haven't put in enough time to fully know all about Red yet, because it's relatively new and there's only so many hours in the day, but if we do some research, I'm sure we can find that out. So I don't have any videos. Let's click on the very top right corner. We have an upload button. Go ahead and click that. From this screen, what we can do is we can start a live stream if we wanted to. We can create a video based on photos. We can create a slideshow, a basic slideshow here, take it to the editor, and then also import. If you've already got photos in your Google account, you can import them here to make a slideshow video. But we've got a video here to work with. Before I select the video, there's a little button here. Mine says private, yours might have changed, but there's public, unlisted, private, and there's also one more, I believe, of, I think they call it scheduled. I might not have that feature because my account hasn't been verified, but you might have that extra feature of scheduled where you can set it. This video will activate tomorrow at 7 a.m. So I can set this up. Instead of being chained to the computer, I automate this to some degree and it automatically makes itself public this week, next week, the following week. I don't have that because I believe I haven't verified this account. Public, obviously, is that everyone's going to be able to see it. They can search for it on YouTube and possibly find you. If they have the link, they can get to it. So it's completely public. If you do a Google search, your video might show up. Unlisted is that it's on YouTube, but no one can see it unless they have the link. If they do a search, they won't find it. If they do a Google search, they won't find it. If they have the link, they can get to it. If they share that link to their 50 friends, then they can all see it. That's not super secure. It's just that you're not going to be able to find it. Just like in the phone book. My name's not in the phone book. My phone number's not in the phone book. But if someone shares my phone number in different ways, they can still find me. And private is that it's your video. Only you can see it. Although I have seen it, it's a little different on here. I don't know if they changed it or it's the particular unverified account. But I have seen on private, if you set it there, you can specify the people that you want to see it. Do any of you see anything if you set yours on private there to share it with specific people? They might have removed it, or my particular account is unverified, so I don't get that. What to decide to put here? One school of thought is to select private because we want to do search engine optimization onto our video. We don't want everyone to see our video until it's ready. Sometimes I do that, but usually I already have the plan of how I'm going to optimize it the moment that I upload it. So if I don't have that idea yet, I might set it to private, do the optimization, then set it to public. I'm going to keep it on public. But if you're doing this for real or just for class activity, you can decide whatever you want here. And you can switch it back and forth between the different ones. Yes?
I put the private on a video I already had up here. Mm-hmm. And then it says only you can view, but then it has a share button. And I get a pop-up, and I can add email addresses.
Okay, that's what I was looking for. But what if you go to your upload button, and from your upload button at that moment, can you choose people on that private?
I only saw that on one I already had.
Okay, it might be then after the fact, then you set it. Okay, so I'm going to keep it on public, and I'm going to click the button there, or you can drag the video, but I'll click the button. And on my desktop, I've got the copy of the video from last time, or your own video if you'd like. So I'm going to select to open that. my 1 minute 2 second, 22 second video uploaded super fast. I think I saw that it went up to like 158 megabit upload speed. So again, for us it was very fast because we've got fast internet connections at the college. But at home, even your 1 minute video may take 1 or 2 minutes, and that doesn't seem like a long time, but once you start doing maybe 5 minute long videos, 10 minute long videos, whatever, it might take way too long to upload. This is what I was saying earlier about should I set this to public or private, because there's some optimization that we should do with our video at this point. So don't hit that publish button on the top right corner yet. The anatomy of this screen is I get a thumbnail. Mine says upload complete. It might process. Your video will be at this, so we'll have a unique link for all of our videos. I might get some notification about your video will process faster if you encode it in one of these formats. So if I go read that help center, it might tell you when you save your video, choose these settings. We chose the default settings in Movie Maker. We're fine. We have then these different things to set: basics, translation, advanced. Then we've got public, and here we can set public, unlisted, private. And here I do see on this screen, if I set it to private, here's who I can choose who to share it with. Public. Also share on, and I can activate to send this off to Google Plus or Twitter. Back in the old days, you could send this off to Facebook. Facebook and Google are not buddies anymore, so you can't do it that directly. You can still share your YouTube video on Facebook manually by copying and pasting the link to your video from YouTube to Facebook, but in the old days you could select it here too. So this is a time saver. If I've got a Twitter account and I activate that, it'll pop open to say connect to your Twitter account, and eventually when we publish it, we're not going to publish yet, eventually when we publish it, it'll get sent off to Twitter as well as Google, as well as YouTube. So if I've got 50 followers on Twitter, this is one way to start to get more views to my videos on YouTube. Share it also on your other networks. And I can craft the message exactly for you for Twitter here. If I don't, it'll just take what it can from what I've written over here. But if I want to craft a specific message on Twitter, such as putting in a hashtag, such as, you know, new video, find out how to blah blah blah. So I can write a tweet here and activate the Twitter link, and it'll put it on YouTube and it'll send it to Twitter as well with that message. I can add to a playlist, and I can create playlists at the moment here. This one is a bit of the chicken or the egg, which comes first. Right now, the way we're doing it, I'm uploading this video about the Tech Review Tuesday, episode 4. So I might have had a plan that I'm going to every week review some form of technology. So I want to put all of those into a playlist. Again, because if someone watches one of the videos, we could then send them to the next video, and then your next video, and your next video, if you put them in a playlist. So just to see how this works, as I'm uploading it, I also want to create a playlist to add it to. Call this Tech Review Tuesday. Everything that we're typing in any of these screens are these keywords that people could be searching for. I can make this a public playlist, unlisted, or private.
I can delete this later on.
Yes. All your playlists, you can keep changing them how you want. Or the video itself.
The video's also right. Mm-hmm.
Yes. So here then, it shows that I'm adding this video to this playlist. And every week when I create a new one of these, I will keep adding it to that playlist. YouTube will then organize it. And when someone watches a video, they can watch the next one. There's a spot here about choosing a thumbnail, and because my account is not verified, I'm missing a very important thing. Because mine's not verified, I have to choose one of these frames that it rather randomly selected, somewhere in the middle of the video, somewhere at the end of the video, somewhere at the beginning. It chose one of these possible thumbnails, not very smart at all, just somewhere randomly at the beginning, middle, or end. And the one that it shows here in the middle is kind of good. Maybe I want that one. But what I'm missing is when I verify my account, I will have upload. I can upload my own cool thumbnail.
Custom thumbnail?
Custom thumbnail, exactly. If you verified, like some of these, like this one right here. This one is clearly a custom one. It's not just a screenshot of the movie. They wrote a little circle and they pointed, and they put their logo in. That was a custom thumbnail. This one seems like a screenshot. Some of these, okay, that one right there, How to Be a Ninja 2.0. That one is a design, most likely, that they made in Photoshop or whatever. All of these ones about this reaction videos from this is clearly a screenshot. A photo that they made. World's best popcorn. So for
example,
not yet. So just looking quickly right here, out of all of these world's best popcorn videos, which one would you want to watch? The best looking one here, of course. The one that's got the popcorn and it's really telling you how great it is. Whereas this one, his head's cut off. And this one right here, I can't tell she's eating popcorn. This one right here, the color looks so weird and yellow. So I'm just showing you here that if you have your account verified, you can do a custom thumbnail. That was something created in Photoshop. And basically, YouTube thumbnail size, 1920 by 1080 pixels, so an HD sized picture. If you create your graphic in that size in Photoshop, you upload it, then they will resize it to every size necessary. A little thumbnail like here, a larger one for the iPad version, a different sized one for the Nexus tablet. You know, YouTube will automatically show the appropriate size thumbnail where necessary, so you should upload the high quality one like that. So in my case, I can't upload a thumbnail, I'd have to choose one. But you want to verify, so you can choose a custom thumbnail. And you have to think small. When you design your thumbnails, you have to think, even though you're designing it that big, 1920, you still have to think about it small. I usually zoom out in Photoshop down to about 8%, because that's roughly the size then I will see it when it's actually on YouTube. And the point of that is if you write really detailed text, like if I have chosen this thumbnail right here, it might not be that visible, that readable. Or if I designed a graphic in Photoshop with small text like that, remember it's going to shrink it down to these sizes, so it might not be very visible. Like this right here, from where you guys sit. That's not really readable, is it? It's a little more readable. It's a little more readable. It's a little too ornate. Very readable. Look how big that text is. Some big part of the picture, very plain, big text. Because oftentimes these thumbnails show up pretty small. So then working backwards, then in this section here, you've got a spot for keywords, for tags, again, to get found by. These ones that are here are some default ones that I set up on that other screen. If they're not relevant, I can take them out, and then I can add tags, like Albert Einstein, Flying Pig, Mashup. I'm going to write, doesn't matter capitalization or not, Motorola, Moto E. The thing about these tags is that they get added when you do a comma or a tab. So if I'm writing Motorola and then I press comma or tab, that's a tag right there that people can search for, Motorola. Or I can do Motorola Moto E. Now that whole thing there is a tag. So here we should put 5 to 10 tags about what this video is. similar in the concept of hashtags on social networks like Twitter, although you shouldn't overload the tags, just like you shouldn't do that on Twitter, then you look spammy. So I'm saying maybe 5, maybe up to 10 or so.
Well, good. Yeah, I always wondered about that.
It's going to be detrimental because just like every aspect of SEO, if I'm cramming my website with keywords, even like keywords that don't even make sense, that's detrimental.
Yeah, no, but like let's say, you know how, what's the thing called, I always forget the name, you know that synonyms thing that Google has, you know, I forgot what they call it. But yeah, like say, I don't know, like say on that, you put, Motorola E, Android, ice cream sandwich. Like, if you put all these totally relevant things, you know what I mean? If you put a lot of things that all make sense, is that okay? Or is that still a bad thing?
No, that's definitely better. Things that make sense. But at a certain point, there's diminishing returns.
Yeah.
Because then you have to think, are people really still going to search for some of those that I
yeah.
think are relevant, but are people really going to search for them? So if you think about your first 5 ones have to be super relevant,
mm-hmm.
your first 10 ones are still very relevant, and then when you go past that, 20 hashtags, 15 of them, 30 of them, that at a certain point it's diminishing returns. Yeah, the first ones I would focus on, the first group of 5 to 10. So I've got these here. Maybe I have some sort of personality that I do online, and I've got Victor Tech. Not separate words, but that's the personality. Maybe that's the name of my channel, my website, my name on Twitter, some sort of keyword that is part of my brand. So. Those are some there. I can get more detailed about the video. Those are helpful because that's tags that people could search for.
This isn't like case sensitive or anything like that?
No. Then we back up over here to the title. On mine it seemed to have cut it off, but where did it cut it off? I remember why. Because in my default settings, I had set it that I'm usually going to do how-to videos. So let me just show that. If you recall back on our channel, upload defaults, I started to set it up like this. Every video is going to start with how-to. If I don't have anything there, it will automatically take the file name of your file. So my file name was Tech Review Tuesday, Episode 4, Motorola Moto E. That would have been better in this case because that's basically what I want to write there. And this aspect here is one of the many also about SEO. Here you have to think about, you're going to have a limited amount of space when people search. I'll do this, Motorola, Moto E, review. Let's see what other people are doing. So obviously a handcrafted icon, because everyone's got an opinion. Then we've got the title. These guys simply say Moto E review. This one says Motorola, Moto E 2015 version, review. This one, Motorola, Moto E second gen, best budget smartphone? Review. So they're doing it a little bit better. They're in third place here, but they're doing it here in that they're saying what they're doing and they're being very specific. They've got best budget smartphone. Someone might be searching for that. Best budget smartphone, and then this video might appear. These guys over here did unboxing and review. Maybe someone is searching for Motorola Moto E unboxing. So those keywords would be hit with them. So this idea of what to write here could be somewhat difficult to figure out what to write here, because I just thought, okay, I'll put the name of my weekly show, the Tech Review Tuesday, and I'm putting episode 4, and then I'm putting in what I'm reviewing. And that's fine, that could work, but I feel that's using up a lot of real screen real estate for a little too much branding that might not help you. it might not be so good to always say the Tech Review Tuesday part. The most important part here is the product itself. So perhaps the way I would write this is to first have Motorola Moto E and then dash Tech Review Tuesday. And do I really need to say episode 4 here? Because I've got a description that I can write in just a moment. So what's the first thing you're going to show people when they search? Just browsing this, look at all that blue. The blue stands out better than the black right here. That's what's going to draw people's eyes. Motorola Moto E unboxing and review. Nuevo Motorola Moto E review en español. So think about catching that attention here. And then there's going to be the description, which is going to be cut off anyway. You can write a lot, but not a lot will be shown. So Motorola Moto E Tech Review Tuesday. Again, well, I've got a lot of competition for that particular phone. So other ways that I could possibly write this. The best phone of 2016, Motorola Moto E. I'm going to be reviewing it and talking about it and why it's so good. So maybe that's what I want to write there for people to find it. And then after that, I've got a spot right here to write as much as I want in the description. Show a video over here.
You're gonna modify my voice, right?
I was working for a germ card.
Okay, so this particular video here is 23 minutes long. It's got a good amount of views. Okay, this topic is a deep topic. It's a long video. Have you seen videos that have some form of length, and then you see this, where you can jump to the particular point in time? You can do this. So this is one video that I worked on. So if you want to go, this is, you know, top 5 tips. Take me to tip number 1 right now. So if you click on that, it'll jump you right to 15 minutes, 40 seconds. That is super easy to do. That is simply, when you write your description, you write a time code. Now, you need to know where you're going to jump to in your video. So, you know, when you play back your video in Movie Maker or whatever, you know, if I play this one back here.
Good, because it's
and
very
I need
powerful.
To, and I need to know to jump people to this point in the video. Well, I need to know where that time code is. We've got seconds, we've got minutes. So, the way you do it is simply in the description you write that time code. 00 minutes colon seconds. Into 7 seconds the intro starts. Then we've got 4 minutes 21 seconds, 20 minutes 21 seconds, etc. So you can jump to, you can have people jump to those different points in your video. This is obviously a very short video, so if you put it, yeah, jump to 22 minutes and 19 seconds, that time doesn't exist, so I don't know what happens, but that time doesn't exist. So all you need to do is, when you're writing this description, is write that. Let's say I'm going to write here sections, and then at 1 minute and 3 seconds, the conclusion. This will become an active link after you publish it, but it's simply you write your time codes here, to allow people to jump to those sections.
You know how when you embed, when you can share and you embed, and there are kinds of, all kinds of little like short code kind of options trying to play a certain way or auto start or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything for the time code fit? Like start right in the middle.
Yes, when you are sharing a video, you select share, you can say right here, start at a certain time. So if you've got it at 4 minutes, 12 seconds, this code, notice it's just simply adding an extra parameter on the time right there. Besides that, you can't do multiple ones, but that's one good one. So again, okay, what are you going to write in this description? You have as much space as you want, because in this particular one, let's break down. This is obviously the highly boring topic of investing, but I do have an interest in it, and I like to share that with people. And the short answer is this: anyone can do this, and it is valuable. And the advice is no one's going to make you a millionaire except yourself. So if you start off as soon as you can to start saving and investing, one day you'll be retired and you'll have money and a good life and take vacations and all that good stuff. So watch that video to get some tips. But what I've got in the description is, in the title I've got these keywords, right? 5 investing tips for beginners. And then there's a little bit of text here, and then the chapters, and then you can have active links as well. So here I'm saying, a lot of these info came from great sources, such as this book on Amazon, The Elements of Investing. And then I've got a link, an affiliate link over to Amazon. So you can put active links in this description as well to guide people from one thing to another. Send us an email through our link to get a TD Ameritrade promotional offer. So again, we just need some kind of link, put it into your description, and it becomes an active link. Yes?
No, they always want you to kind of, like you did here, but you know, disclose that there's like some kind of a commission or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Is just putting a failure like that cool? I mean, do you have to get all crazy? I mean, is that?
I did do a little research, and there's not a lot of consensus, but this seems one of the ways.
Okay.
Some of the big names that I saw that they do it, they also
did
it that way. So I'm just kind of following along what the big ones have done.
Because
there was a huge video that says, am I allowed to put Amazon affiliate links? And it was like 10 minutes long, and they never got to a good answer, because even Google, YouTube themselves don't give a good answer about that. So they say what we've done in our years, and we haven't been flagged in any of our videos, is to just be honest and say this is an affiliate link, however you want to say it.
Hey, because some people get crazy. Oh, by the way, I'm getting paid, but it's cool. I use it myself. Why don't you just put affiliate or something?
Yeah. Yeah, you don't have to go through the whole 9 yards of saying, I use this product and I love it. Also, I'm not just a user, I'm a member.
Just affiliate, cool.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Question?
Yeah, do those timestamps mess with your analytics at all? Like, you know how it'll record like your views and your
in theory,
time,
it,
how much you've seen the video?
In theory, it does, because here you could be artificially having people quickly to keep jumping to a certain time. So it will show you in your analytics, as you view a particular video, you know, some engagement for this amount of time, and maybe it drops down, but then maybe it comes back up because people keep jumping to that point in the video. If that's good and bad, good or bad, I can't quite say. But what does happen is you could be skewing people to see a particular portion of your video that may be good. Maybe, you know, I'm not saying you're going to make a boring 30-minute video, but you know that 27 minutes of it is boring, but the last whatever minutes is gold. So you could be guiding people to that point by having it in the description. The problem is, think about yourself. How often do you really go that far into your description? And notice how little YouTube shows. Barely 3 lines here. I'm barely getting to the point of showing chapters. So if you're not showing chapters until one more line down, no one's ever going to know that there's chapters there. Maybe start talking about your chapters right away to guide people to those sections. So YouTube gives and YouTube takes. Because you guys tell me, how oftentimes do you go look at more of the description of a video?
Especially in mobile.
What's that?
Especially in mobile.
Even smaller space.
Yeah.
So there's good and bad here. The ones that perhaps are really dedicated might actually look, you know, out of these 438,000 views, I'd love to know how many really are are actually kind of looking at all of this. And one way to kind of see this is working, I can check my Amazon affiliate control panel and see some clicks do come from that, but not the 300 that have actually even seen it. So this this description here, keep in mind you can write as much as you want, but basically the first three lines are the ones that are going to be visible right away. So if it's very important for you to make these sections or chapters or however you want to call them, you might want to make it obvious to people that those exist above the fold, above the show more. Yes.
Do you know how you put check affiliate link and it was like a really long like a bare link? Does this support doing it in a tag? HREF or whatever source?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't take an HTML.
It doesn't accept any.
It'll just take your link and make it live. Yeah, because this one right here, it's a pretty big one. That obviously I can go over to Bitly and such and shorten it. And this one from Amazon is the short link, but this one, I suppose I could have, and then gotten more analytics out of that from Bitly, and I just put it into there as is. But I got that little emoji to hopefully catch people's attention. So that might be another way. We've all seen these things. We're all getting numb to various aspects of things. What about if you throw in some emojis here and there? And then so when you've got these descriptions, something is different to look at that might further catch attention.
And the support for that emoji would be dependent on the browser or?
The operating system. The viewer, technically, because I've noticed that depending how you view some emoji, they look a little different. So again, what to write here exactly will be up to you to a large portion, but think of in terms about people are searching, what can you write here to get people to find it? So in this case, again, think in terms about why the person would care. A little bit less perhaps about my branding. I wouldn't really write Victor reviews another product here. I would start to write something more like the best phone that you need for the money. Are you on a budget? Here's the best phone. Thinking in those terms. So are you on a budget? Check out the best phone money can buy. Victor reviews the Moto E. And because you've got that little spot for you to write something, maybe you really want to have some sort of call to action about what to do. Maybe here I would put my link. Help us out and buy it. And then your link.
Will it hyperlink like Twitter handles like at or like hashtag?
Not hashtags. I don't believe hashtags. And I don't believe Twitter names also. But other account names, I don't think I've noticed those. I don't think I've really noticed people doing that, so source Bloomberg, subscribe on Bloomberg, just randomly choosing things.
He's worth over 11.
It's like, oh, look, there is a hashtag right there.
What does that go to?
It goes over to a search. It does seem to be a search. So hashtag little man, and it did a search. Did a search on YouTube.
Does that pound in front of it affect the search result, you think, or not?
That probably activates the search.
Oh,
I'm going to try that right now. So I'm going to just do hashtag Motorola. We'll see what it looks like when I publish it, but from what I'm seeing here, the hashtag seems to have created a search in YouTube. And then all of these other YouTube videos and external videos. So this one's pretty long. Again, above the fold, there's this tiny amount of space right here. And all they wrote was, he has created game-changing businesses like PayPal, Tesla Motors, and SpaceX. And then there's all of this other stuff read this, read this, read this, 10 rules of success. I would have loved to learn that right away. But it's way down here. There's no space for it anyway. Sources and engage, connect, Evan, schedule. Lots of info. You can write as much as you want. You can tag people in comments. We'll get to that later. Notice how these people, so Evan right here, tagged that other channel with the plus symbol like a Google Plus link. So you can tag others.
So it tagged them kind of to like their Google Plus account.
Let me confirm on that one. You can tag other people's YouTubes. This is going to another YouTube. When you tag them, it's in the syntax of Google Plus, but it sent them off to the channel. And they put in here the hashtag also, so BTA120 hashtag. So I didn't know that. I don't think I knew that. Looks like hashtags do create a Google. It looks like hashtags do create a YouTube search.
But it's not like they send you to Twitter.
No, they want to keep you on YouTube. Okay, so I've written some stuff here. There's link, put in a hashtag, time codes. So that's this screen here, basic info. Let's look at the other screens here. Any questions so far? If we look at translations, whatever you wrote here, then you can go into translations and create multiple versions in different languages. You can buy a translation. So let's say this product would be great to be viewed on a variety in a variety of countries in different languages. So you can create descriptions and titles in other languages. So if I do say I'm going to add a new language, the original one is in English, and then we'll do another one, Tamil. Mm-hmm. From Sri Lanka, obviously. So here I can write, if I knew Tamil, I would write the description and the title in that language, and now people can search in that language and possibly find my video. So here I don't have anything to work with. Advanced settings. Okay, this one's a lot of good stuff here. Here is where you can, on a case-by-case basis, change your commenting system. This particular video is going to be too hot to handle, so I'm going to turn off comments because I don't want any crazy people bothering. Or I can do the approved comments, or you know, let them all go in, or me approve them. And the default then is, as people start to comment, the best comments will show up first. And the best comments come from other people also liking comments, because people can like, people can upvote or downvote people's comments. So right here, this person, what kind of lamp is the one that you use? And then a couple people upvoted it. So the best ones will show up first, which people can change. Just show me the newest one. But we've set it that the best comments show up first. That's up to you to change. There shouldn't be any bearing on anything. But the point of that is to try to take away, you know, the negative comments, the spam comments, the troll comments. If people are commenting and it's a good comment, they're going to give a thumbs up, and those are going to rise up and push down the bad ones. Do you want people to view how many of those ratings and such that you have, yes or no? Here's the thing again about the, this one is the ownership about, do you want your video, as we talked about these things last time, do you want it, you know, with some amount of protection from YouTube, from other people stealing it, or do you want Creative Commons, which is basically a little bit more free-for-all with an attribution back to you? The default is fine. Would you like your video shown everywhere or only on monetized platforms? I never set up monetization on this, so I don't have that option. But on this, you could have your video only show up on places where you can make money off of it. So there's everywhere, and there's platforms. There's the caption again, allow embedding and notify subscribers. Would you like to let people take your video and show it on their website? And that might not be a bad thing. This one here about free energy magnet with 13 million views might want to be shared over to other people's websites. So every video by default, and yours too, has this share ability. Share it all to the other social networks. So here's another way to get it to Facebook. You have to do it manually. Embed it, disabled by request. You cannot copy this video easily from YouTube over to your website. You can email it to people. And that's what this is saying here. Allow people to embed it, yes or no? Nope, yes. When you get subscribers and you leave this on, they will get a notification. There's a new video from Victor's Tech Tips. If you don't want people to know that, you can turn it off. Do you need to restrict the age of the video here? Is it, you know, is it about sex or violence or alcohol or controversial things that you don't want certain ages to see? You can activate that, and they will have to sign in to YouTube and verify an age before they can see the video.
There's no like backward thing on the age, because like my daughter watches YouTube for kids, and they have like only age appropriate stuff there.
I think this is about that. That if you activate this, this video would be in that realm of age appropriate. Prevents underage users from watching. This also removes the ability to monetize or promote your video through different ad formats.
It's like removing it.
Category, so you would choose a category, location, language of the video, community, allow viewers to contribute subtitles. We set that up at another point. Recording date, it will automatically get the date that you uploaded it, but if you want this to be at a different time, you can go in and change that.
Is the video location off like the file data or like
This was set when we went over to the settings. It doesn't take it automatically. It's blank. It doesn't know. So when we were at channel upload defaults, I went in here somewhere and I said, I'm in San Diego. Video stat, make my stats public or not. Is my video in 3D? So if I upload a specially encoded video for 3D, people can watch my video in 3D. It used to be a few different formats, but 3D didn't seem to take off. So it's kind of just uploading it in the side-by-side format. So the person needs the right kind of gear to watch it. So if you have that, content declaration, this video contains a paid product placement or endorsement. So partners are permitted to include paid product placements or endorsements in their content. All product placements will need to conform to our ad policies. I believe that is slightly different than putting in the description simply like an affiliate link. This is more that in the video contains that I said, hey everyone, I love this product, don't forget to buy it, follow the link below. That's much more of what it's saying there, that there's an actual paid product placement in the video. And if it does, you should activate that because you could get flagged. Someone could rat you out and say it doesn't have that, and then YouTube will find out, or YouTube could find out itself. Best case scenario, they take the video down. Worst case scenario, they cancel your account if you do it too much. This is under, I'm still editing the video, and it's under advanced settings. Yes.
So what about those things where they're like, this video is brought to you by, and they literally cut, and they go like, oh, you know, Bluehost hosting account, blah, 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 and then they go back to their regular scheduled program. You know what I mean? I'm sure you've seen those before, right?
Usually the way I see them is that they cut in during a video.
Yeah, like right in the middle, you know? Sometimes I mention it at the beginning, you know?
What's your question?
Sorry.
Linus Tech Tips that says one guy that does that, and then he'll have his in the middle of his videos he'll be like, today's video is brought to you by, and he'll bring up a hard drive from Seagate, blah blah blah.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Now that I think about it, I have seen several like that. I'm pretty sure it relates to this, that you do have to say that, because that is that product placement or endorsement right in the middle of the video. They take time out of the video to then say, here's an ad. So you should activate that. However, there's also the mid-roll ads, which is that some video is playing, and especially for the longer videos, suddenly an ad appears in the middle without really the person saying, here's an ad. That's slightly different. But this one is more like in the middle of the video, you're going to take time to tell people this is an ad, this is a product. You say Linus or Linux?
Yeah, Linus. There you go, right there, Linus. Yeah, that's the guy. Oh, almost every video has some kind of commercial, like right in the middle, or even starts off. See, sponsored by Intel. And then somewhere along the way, there's that cutaway. And they're like, Intel's cool, you should buy one.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure the short answer is that they've got that item activated, that check mark.
Mm-hmm. As long as you get it, you're cool, right?
Yeah, if something else doesn't trip you up, because there's so many things here that, especially when it comes to this monetization, there's a lot of things that you agree to when you activate that sometimes we don't realize what's there.
Yeah, like now YouTube is entitled to half the revenue.
There was a guy that I used to watch a few years ago that every day he made a new video about his life, and it was really fun, and he had a cool time, and then like he was going to make a video for a video every day for the whole year. So he was like all the way into September, and he'd been on a great record, he'd been doing it all. Then he was in September, and then suddenly in September he fell off one day, and then when he came back the next day he posted a really sad video of himself saying YouTube took me down and they're going to take away all my revenue that I've been making so far and I'm so bummed. And I don't know, he claims that, he says that YouTube claims that he clicked on his own ads to get the money. So he says he didn't, but something happened and he lost his money. So those are those horror stories there.
Like not only did they stop giving him revenue, but they like demanded the previous.
Well, the way that it works is you need to have a certain threshold before they pay you out. So it was what you would call unrealized gains.
Oh.
So they just said, you haven't gotten the money
yet.
So
he had like a counter, like a ticker saying, oh, dude, don't worry, keep going, get
yeah.
the money, and then he never got the money.
Yeah. So. Now, if you did set up monetization, there will be one more tab here. I can't show it to you, but if you set up monetization, there will be here the option, turn on ads, yes or no. And then a few other sub-options, such as, allow ads before or after your video, during your video. There's like three or four to five different check marks to activate. Usually you want to activate them all to try to get the most revenue out of your videos if you're going to do monetization. Again, I can't show it here, and I don't have any other channels here to show you that I'm logged into at the moment. But you'll have one more tab, monetization. So you can turn it on or off for your videos. And that's got some caveats here and there, such as if you activate age restricted, then you can't monetize, because kids are much easier to manipulate via advertising and marketing. So they're gonna say you can't do that. If you
I think that's backwards though. I think the age restrictions are saying, hey, my video says a bad word, so I don't want kids to watch it, right?
Yes and no. It says prevents underage users from watching their videos, so you can't let underage users watch it. But then it says also removes the ability to monetize or promote your videos. So it's both. If you have on your basic info, if you set this over to private, then you lose monetization on that too, because it's private. No one can really see it. I'm not sure with unlisted, but really with public, that's the most public way, and then you can add monetization and make money off of that. So I just got an email right now from Google that says, ready to publish your video? So it's waiting for me to hit that publish. So this is what I'm saying about if I have the idea of what I want to do, I would leave it on public and then go for it. But if I still need to figure out what am I going to write, what am I going to do about this, I would have it set to private, and then I can come back to the video manager to then finish crafting that and then publishing it. But I'm assuming I kind of know what I want to do at this point, so I'll go forward. But any questions on any of these others? So again, for this class, if this is just for test, maybe just put it on private, or if it doesn't matter, leave it public, whatever. This can be deleted. But I'm going to go ahead and publish. So now my video has been published. Here's the link to it. I can show you where else to get it later. But here's the link. From this screen, I can also send it off over to Tumblr. Even though I didn't have it to automatically set it to Tumblr, I can send it to Tumblr or Pinterest or whatever from this screen or another screen that I'll show you over to Reddit.
This one, so, or just...
If you want to, if this is a real video or whatever and you can want to delete it later, you can publish it now, sure. This screen also gives me here the embed code. Copy and paste this code into my blog, for example, to show a video. So, for example, over here on my blog, comics, I've got this one, this video that I made about comics, and there it is. It's on my blog, but I didn't upload it to my site. It's on my YouTube. YouTube is going to store it and serve it to people and have it protected and all of that. YouTube never goes down. And so I just put the embed code of that video from my YouTube channel onto my site with this embed code, and then I can have my video here.
What do those UPC symbols on your favorite comics mean anyway? Let's find out. So what do those UPC symbols on your favorite comics mean anyway? Let's find out.
So most of the time nowadays, when you buy a comic...
So anyway, there's that video, and it's 13 minutes long, and then it's just embedded onto the channel. YouTube is the one serving the video, and you can reap the rewards in that it doesn't take up your server space or your bandwidth and so forth.
And then, of course, send that via email. They'll get an email that basically says... That this account has shared a video, the link to the video, and a little bit of that description. You can either go to it by clicking on the video manager there, or you can always get back to the video manager by clicking on your Creator Studio icon on the top right. It says I've got one video now here, no analytics yet, and then I see Video Manager there on the left. So a couple ways. Oops, I guess I left feed restricted on. But here then it tells you there's your thumbnail, there's a video, it's an HD, time of upload, a few things we'll look at there in a moment. Quick stats here, how many views, feed restricted, or other things. If you monetize it, you'll see a little dollar symbol. So all your videos that are monetized will be listed. At a glance, you'll get comments. Thumbs up, thumbs down. You can click to view the analytics of that video, or you can go to analytics screen, and this will tell you in general various stats. You can go directly to specific videos as well. So I put the wrong item there. I need to go back to edit my video. So notice we've got here, edit. I'll take a quick look at it here. If you go to edit, it takes you back to this screen, slightly rearranged. But here I can go back to edit the video if I want to rewrite my description, change my tags, all of that. Under advanced, I put it age restricted. So if I save that now, it's not age restricted. There's the link to my video again. The original raw file. Thumbnails, if I had it verified, I would be able to upload my own. I'll go back to videos again. This drop-down button, these various screens right here, these various links right here, are also screens that you can get to by going to edit.
We'll look at some of these in a moment. But notice here, you can re-download your file again. If you had a hard drive crash and lost all of your original files, at the very least, YouTube still has a copy of the original raw file and you can download again.
The video, or is that just the whole video, the MP4?
Just the MP4. You know, the...
The music?
Everything about the video, the completed video that is up on YouTube.
Oh.
We've got this promote, which takes you to the whole thing about, let's set up a way for you to promote your videos. And guess what? Not for free. So I'm not going to touch on that too much, but this could be a way for you to get more views on your videos. And if that's valuable, you know, you go through this campaign and you take out your credit card and you're going to promote your video.
What if it balances out? You promoted it so well that the revenue you got from the ad.
It could be, definitely. You spend a little. It is true. You need money to make money. So if you put in maybe $20 to promote this, it might come back and you get $50 out of it.
Yeah, they say that there's like some kind of like point of, I don't know what you call it, but like you push a video far enough that a lot of the big time companies do that. They'll pour a lot of money into promoting a video because they know after a certain point, like you said, popularity breeds popularity. But by this point, everyone and their mother has heard about this now. And then they turn on the revenue part of it, and then they gain back the money that they invested.
Definitely. And the more you do it, the more you get better at maybe finding that demographic that'll help push you over the edge, or the kinds of videos that you create. So without too much of a plan to just invest to get a lot of hits, that might not be the best. After I create maybe 5 or 6 videos and I'm kind of getting a hang of it and who really is paying attention, then I might spend more on the promotion to get more out of it. And then there's delete. So if then you don't want to deal with this video, fake video anymore, you can just click down there and delete it. Let's look at a little bit more about what you can do with your video here. If you go back to edit, we saw this editing area right here. But then what you've got at the top, you can do some enhancements. You can explore that on your own, but that's a little bit of basic, you know, like maybe shaky camera fixes and such. If you want to swap the audio, I hardly find much use here, but if you uploaded a video with no sound and you wanted to add sound to it, you can add sound here, although that'll wipe out the existing sound, I think. Let's see what happens. I'm gonna
do
E. Bland. I do have a little thing here. Only music. Favorite music. Favorite original audio. So again, I hardly use this because I get one of these songs off of the creator library and then I put it all in Movie Maker exactly how I want. Here it's kind of not very precise.
This all popped up when you hit that edit button?
Yes. When you edit your song, then you have info, enhancements, and audio.
Hello everyone, right. This is Victor Couples for the...
Then we've got, let me do these two in a moment, subtitles. So subtitles could be useful because what about if you've got some sort of tutorial? What if you think in terms about people that watch a video but can't hear it for various reasons? Maybe they're in an environment that there's no headphones, they can't play it and such. So what could be valuable is to have captions in my video. There's different ways to do it here. I can write the captions myself. I can invite my community to contribute, so I can have other people help me write the captions. And then I've also got the ability to get YouTube to start captioning for me. Let me see. Transcribe and auto sync. So I can start typing. What was spoken here? I can type it. It'll transcribe it. It'll sync it up with me or for me.
I remember doing this, and it, there you go. I remember it doing it for me, and then I just had to edit stuff. I think it's
Yeah, let me go back to show that. So there's the auto captions that if you click on auto captions, here's YouTube, here's Google itself trying to make captions for me. So let's see how accurate it is. Hello everyone, this is Victor Campos with the Tech Review Tuesday. You totally missed the part that I said, hello everyone, this is Victor Campos with the Tech, it started with Tech Review Tuesday. So it missed all of that. Today I've got some new hardware for you. This today of that, some hardware for you. Instead of today, I've got some hardware for you. This is the Motorola.
You can edit it.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting toward. So this, to some degree, might be very helpful. It already kind of wrote some amount of text at the spot that it seems to match up with my face. So what I can do is, that's what's been written, I can go in there and edit it. Override existing subtitles, sure. So I can go in and say, hello everyone. I set an exclamation point. This is Victor for the, capitalize that, Tech Review Tuesday, period. Today, oops, hello. So now if I play it, hello everyone, this is Victor Campos for the Tech Review Tuesday. Today I've got some new hardware for you. So this is one way to do this. I can start with these auto captions and then myself start to work on them right here, right in the editor. I could also up on Actions download. Let me start over here. I can take what I started to write here, I mean what it thinks I said, and then select to download it in these different formats. It doesn't matter the format, really. You just download it, and then you can open a text editor and fix what's there. If you do it this way, you don't have the luxury of checking what's written with what's in the video. So any way you want to do it, it's annoying. The machine is not smart enough to do the caption. But over for example, for educational institutions, whenever there's any video provided as official content for a class, it must be, according to law, be captioned. So we have a department on campus, also at San Diego City College, where I also teach at. They have a department of people that do this, that I give them my video, in theory, and they go in, and then they go in and listen to it and write it down and fix it and everything and give me the result. So this might be an accessibility requirement. It's required that you have captions so that everyone can listen to your video. So it might not be that I didn't bring my headphones. It might be that someone is deaf. They can't hear your video. But if you added captions to your video, then they'll be able to see your video, still enjoy it, still use it, and then you've reached more people. So that's captions. Then we've got annotations and cards. I'll mention these briefly. Annotations are ways for you to add boxes, stuff on screen. Click here. You see this all the time. You see YouTube videos that this pops up here, this pops up there. It's all here under annotations. You can go in and experiment with styles and colors and all of that stuff. You can figure it out. The point, though, is I believe that people are really numb to these things. We've had YouTube for a decade. Many of us have used it that long, or several years, and we just ignore these. They're in the corner often. We don't even pay attention. If they're right in the middle, they're so annoying, and then we click the X to hide it. So I think we're getting a little numb to these kinds of ways to get attention on the video. YouTube saw that, and then now they've got a new generation of these things, which is cards. So, cards now. Cards are a way for you to also you know, get people's attention, to have them click on something or do something, but they look different in that they pop up on the side over here. For example, here looking at these tech tips, this little info icon on the top right, these are the cards. Here's this to click on, that one to click, follow this link, etc. These kinds of annotations are not as intrusive. Someone has to click to view it, but then they look much more interesting. Then they can click on that rather than something that pops up right here that annoys me. So this may be something that works or doesn't. I haven't really seen stats about how popular this is, but this is the new generation of it. I like it. I've been using it. And what you can do is add a card so that it links to another video or playlist of yours or someone else's. Promote another channel. So I might have a channel all about my cooking stuff and a channel all about my technology stuff. So I can cross-promote channels. I haven't done this one myself, but this one seems kind of cool. Using a poll to ask a couple of questions. Do you guys like this or do you like that better? And then people can vote in the middle of your video. And then a link to an approved website. If you're going to do to external websites, there's a thing that you have to agree to about the policies. Of course I agree, so I'll click accept. Now if I do here, I have a link. I have to verify my account, I haven't done it yet. I have to associate a website. Remember there was a screen under settings that says put your website. So once I do those two, then I will be able to link either to my homepage of my website, or a merchandise site, or a crowdfunding funding site, the ones that are approved here. So I could create a card to link to some of these over here, list of approved retailers, Bandcamp, Big Cartel, Bravado, Dice Cafe Press, Etsy, iTunes. Hot topic. So Amazon isn't there, but at least you can still put your Amazon link in the description. Crowdfunding, so if you want to get donations and such, you can do it on these. Right here, examples of crowd ones. So there's a bunch of them. It's not just it's not just Kickstarter and Indiegogo or GoFundMe. There's all these other ones you never heard of, such as IdeaMe and Fondeadora and CrowdRise, Chuffed, PledgeMe. There's good old Patreon, Tilt, and Makina. So those are the cards. It's a new generation. Of being able to link in different ways to other content in the middle of your video. I use this to cross-promote other videos. There's one of those videos that might have, you know, 100 views and some of them only have got 12. So I can put, if it's relevant, in the video with 300 views, I can put a card there to promote the other videos as well. Get a little traffic to those other ones. So that's a bunch of things we can do regarding regarding editing the video. I'll say one more last thing and then we'll wrap up. I've got 4 views already. I'm rich. So I've uploaded a video. It was probably these great keywords and everything. So it is going to be a large degree about that, about what's your video about, put your keywords, put your subject, all of that stuff. And that'll get you some traffic. The other way you get traffic is also sharing it to your Twitter and your other networks. And here's one more way that you can get traffic to your video. This goes back to the discussion we were having a little while, Sergio, about the spammers linking on videos. We are going to do a version of that, but we're not spammers. So what I'm getting at is that I would search over here for budget smartphone 2016. And I would look at these videos,
And I would look at the ones that have a lot of views. So from 2 months ago, 2 weeks ago, 46,000. So I'm going to go look at Danny Wingate's video of the top 5 budget smartphones, early 2016. And what I'm going to do is I would go down here to the comments and write something positive first and say, excellent review. We have so many great choices. Here's our take. I'm not going to super over the top, click here, buy this, check out my video. Mine's amazing. I'm going to simply slip my link in there for my own video after saying something nice. And post that. And so there you go. That's been shared. It's an active link. A lot of people are looking at this video. A lot of people are commenting, looking at the comments. Someone might see this video, give me a thumbs up, might actually click to watch my video active, which is an active link. I mean, that could get me some traffic. I'm piggybacking on those that have already the popularity. Obviously, the tightrope that we're walking here is to do this without looking like a spammer, without annoying the original poster, because depending how Danny has his channel set up, he set it up so that anyone can comment, which is great for me. But he might go in and delete the comments that he doesn't like. He got a notification right now. Victor VMC Test posted a comment on your video, so he knows about it. He might be so popular that he doesn't go in and clean out the comments, so I could have my comment to be there. So this tactic could verge on a spam tactic, but I'm going to trust you to do it in this kind of way, where you're not going to be really over the top. You're going to be positive. You're going to be part of the conversation. You could also go in here and reply, you know, to one of the people commenting, to MKD360. I could click reply to that. And my comment will show up for people to see, but then here I'm kind of killing two birds with one stone, because now I'm also specifically mentioning MKTD360 and say, the OnePlus X is bomb, but nothing beats the Moto E. And then a link. So at the very least, he'll ignore me. Better than that, perhaps, he'll click the link. I could get a thumbs down on that, sure, or a thumbs up. I could get reported, sure. So worst case scenario is I get reported and all of that. But again, this takes practice and finesse. If you're not comfortable with that, don't do it. There's other ways to do this. You know, keep promoting yourself on Twitter and write your descriptions well and all of that. But I do engage in this a lot, and I've almost never had any negativity out of it, because I start with positivity, and therefore people are also positive, depending on the topic, of course. Because, you know, when you start to argue about what's the best smartphone, you're going to get into a war on that, or the best game console. Be careful on all of that. So
can you do a comment once you put it out?
Yes, you go to your own three dots right there. You can delete it or edit it. Yes.
Did you get a report, or did you get a warning, or did you get?
It depends. You get a warning in the beginning if you get this. If you get reported and such, like let's say right here, that offends me right there. So I'm going to click here and select report. I'm not going to, but if someone did that to me one time, it might not be such a big deal. But if a lot of people are doing that, if whatever I wrote is so terrible that a lot of people are reporting me like that, it could go from I get a warning, you know, a message from YouTube, and I could say your account is temporarily suspended, you know, so I can think about what I did. Worst case scenario, it goes further than that. It says, from our evidence, we need to shut down your account because you've frequently violated our terms of service. They always have within their pocket to say, you violated our terms of service. That huge thing that no one reads, but everyone agrees to, is so much there that could be held against you to shut you down. So this could be a tightrope to walk. Uh,
So I think that's a good amount of YouTube to talk about. Creation of the channel, of the video, of the channel, optimizing, and everything we learned on the other network still applies. But the big idea is you need some video for YouTube. Whereas every other network, you can share photos, you can share text and links. Here, it's a video. And obviously, you're not a pro in video editing on that one day that we had, but go back and watch the video again if you need more help. Take other classes at Southwestern College to get better at video. And you don't have to be a pro. You can just turn on your camera, record and talk, and upload it, and that's it. You might get a viral hit. So any questions on anything we've talked about YouTube?
I had a comment. It's funny, when I logged into my old
channel,
email or whatever, I had bought a iFi. I don't know if you remember those. They're at,
iFi?
SD cards.
Oh, yes, they have a built-in.
Yeah.
They're still around. They're still around.
Yeah, I know. I wanted to check them out. I had it set up so that every time I shot a video, it would automatically upload the videos in private to YouTube, which I thought was kind of cool because it is kind of annoying, like we were talking about at the beginning of the class, the upload time and all that. And I guess if you had that workflow with like iFi or like with your mobile app to auto-upload, auto-put them on private, then at that point it would be feasible to use the in-browser editor.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because your content's already up there.
Yeah, if it's all happening seamlessly.
Yeah. And I started to fart around a little bit with the in-browser editor. It's not that bad. I mean, for, you know, whipping up something real quick, you know, the transitions and the fixes and all the text and all that. Especially if you just want to keep it simple. I thought it was kind of nice.
Yeah, you can even do a little bit of this editing here. I cut some clips together and I put it in a different order. So yeah, it's all right. It might work pretty well. And if you've got that it's got your auto uploads. And then nowadays, if you've got an Android device, it can have that set up so that it automatically goes up to your Google Drive.
Yeah.
All right, so I gave the homework last week, and it's still on 6 views. I've still got the deadline set for next week, so check on Blackboard for the details of the assignment. It's due next week. Create a video on just about anything you want out of those 6 topics. I believe I said, 30 seconds minimum? 1 minute minimum or whatever, so upload that. Send me the link to your video. You can get your video link back here. You go to edit and you'll get that short link. Actually, I believe I asked for your channel link. So if you go back to your dashboard, view channel, that address up there is your channel. So you need to send that to me so I know where your video is and I can grade you. I won't be grading on the quality of your content, really. I'll just be grading at your do this, follow that you created one of the kinds of videos on the list, and remember you can get another extra credit, 2 extra credit points, so 20% if you do a second video. So we'll have a little bit of lab time, that's it. When we come back next time, we'll talk about a new topic, and you'll have your YouTube homework due.